So I look down and they're kind of waiting. And then I realize, oh, maybe I have to deliver something. So if you look at old YouTube videos of me.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I'm doing, trying to figure out what to deliver. So I started going, okay, all right, okay. And they started laughing like you're laughing. And I went, what? Okay, all right. What do you, all right. And that was my whole, okay.
Oh. What a joke with Papa and Fortune.
Welcome to another edition of What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Feimster.
And we're amazing.
Yes.
We really are. Uh-huh. We've been here now. I think we've done 200 shows here at the Montreal Comedy Festival.
Just this week.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's all starting to blur together. We've really done a lot of shows. We've seen a lot of comedians.
Well, that's the beauty of being here.
Yeah, I'm not complaining. Well, I am a little.
It's that time of the week where you're just like, oh boy.
Yeah. we're going to plow through.
Yeah, I mean, it's been so fun.
Can we bring up our first guest?
Please.
I'm excited for this. Shane, why don't you come on up? This is Shane Gillis, everybody.
Hi, Shane.
He's
How's
one of the
going?
New faces.
Here's Sid by
it's
Tom.
It's up to you.
Good to see you, buddy. Welcome.
Good to see you. This is very exciting because you're a new face here at the festival, which is for those of you who are delivering
newspapers
in your car listening to this and don't know what that means in Iowa. Yeah. There are young bucks who are who caught the eye of the comedy world, and they put them out in this show called New Faces, and then all the agents and vultures get to look at them and see if they feel like they can make money off of these young, hopeful people.
Yeah.
And Shane.
Yeah.
Shane's like, sure.
Yeah, that's it. No, that's exactly, yeah.
Yeah, that's it. And I'm excited to sit with you because I noticed something about you. From being outside with all the people smoking weed
yep.
on the sidewalk and stuff.
What'd you notice about
all the
Shane?
People that I know and love from my long career in comedy,
mm-hmm.
All the New York guys, Rich Voss and Soder and all these people,
yeah.
they all like him a lot.
That's high praise.
Yeah. So what's going on? How'd you meet all those guys?
I'm from Harrisburg, like Harrisburg, Pennsylvania.
So
it's actually even further west. I'm from Mechanicsburg.
Oh, that's nice.
Is that where the Amish are or not?
Close, yeah. Close. They're in Lancaster.
Oh,
but,
okay.
Yeah.
Where they shot the deer hunter?
Kind of,
like
yeah.
That?
It looks like that a little.
Nice.
Yeah.
That was...
He's like,
depressing.
I wasn't.
That's what it used to look like. Now we have a Chipotle now.
Ooh.
That's big time.
So things are looking up.
Because that's better than just a regular fast food restaurant.
Yeah.
It's one step above.
I'm actually quitting chewing tobacco right now.
Are you really?
This is day four.
Day four. For how long was this habit?
Like 15 years.
Wow.
Yeah, so we're doing
it. Why are you quitting?
Because it was a lot.
Why are you quitting?
I agree with you.
Why are you quitting? Because no one does it anymore except for... people in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's cool. And maybe
in North Carolina. Oh, I sat by a guy on the plane who started dipping.
On the plane.
And I was like, this is too much.
I've done that, and it's embarrassing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I try to make sure no one's sitting next to me. If you do it while someone's sitting with you, you're an animal.
That's
insane.
That's what I call them, an
it's
animal.
It's really insane. Are you from North Carolina?
I'm from North Carolina.
I went to Elon.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I played football at Elon for a little.
Very
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's probably actually where you picked up.
Yeah, football, it's easy to dip.
Yeah.
That's when I dipped. When I played football in high school, we weren't allowed to drink during the season.
You were a dipper?
So we dipped, well, for like a week.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, oh, you can get buzzed from this.
Yeah.
And then I threw up because I ate some of it, and that was it.
Yeah.
I was like, I'll wait till spring when I can drink again.
What made you decide to quit, though?
I was just doing it too much.
Yeah.
Do it all the time, so.
Mm-hmm. Even on
gotta
stage?
Stop.
How do you feel about
never
it?
On stage.
Never on stage.
Never on stage.
Is it an itchy thing to
I just
quit?
Picked up smoking, to be honest.
Did you really?
Yeah, just smoked a pack of cigarettes the first day I was here. So that's good. Yeah. You guys were talking about how, like, subdued you guys were. After New Faces, I got hammered at that bar.
You did?
Oh.
Well, I saw you the afternoon that you were going to do it. You were doing it that night.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How'd it go?
It went well. It went really well.
Pete Holmes was hosting.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you were up, where in the lineup?
I went last.
You went last?
Yeah.
You closed it out.
I did,
And you crushed everybody?
I'm not going to say that.
Yeah, you did.
No, it went well. It was a good
set.
Yeah, it was fun.
You'll only be considered a real comic if you say, I crush it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I ran the light by 2 minutes.
so what?
Which was, no, exactly.
Yeah, who cares?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah. Oh, you were amazing. We think we can make a lot of money with you, but you went over by 2 minutes, good luck with the rest of your career.
Yeah, but last night, so after New Faces, it was enough that last night I was in bed by 9:30.
Nuh-uh, really?
Really?
Yeah,
good
was
for
reading.
You.
You were reading.
I read a little Cormac McCarthy and went to sleep.
Oh, wow.
How about that?
You.
And
I'm
ready
so
to black out
to
again
you.
Tonight.
You ready to black
I'm
out?
Yeah.
So where do you work in New York?
Mostly at the Stand.
At the Stand.
Yeah, yeah.
And they just reopened, I heard.
Yeah, it's really nice.
Is it?
Yeah.
And then no seller yet?
No.
Not yet?
Not yet.
Have you... Are you waiting or are you trying?
I like kind of auditioned for the Comedy Central show, the This Week at the Cellar.
Yeah.
And I bombed. It was the worst set I've had.
Oh, no.
And they were like, oh, Estee's here. And I was like, oh, great. Yeah, yeah. Because it's supposed
see
to be.
See you in 5 years.
It's like a, yeah, exactly. It's like a topical show.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I didn't prepare. So then I tried to make all my bits topical. And I ended up just doing new material, like they knew.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know what happened.
Well, that's back when you were dipping.
That was the old.
Yeah, you weren't thinking straight. You had tobacco juice going down your throat.
Yeah.
Hey, Alonzo, do you mind sitting out here for
you
want to
come
for
chat
a second?
With us?
We'd love to talk to the great Alonzo Bodden, everybody.
Alonzo, grab a microphone. It's good to see you, bud.
Great to see you guys.
Nice to see you. You hosted New Faces a couple
times. I hosted New Faces a few times. I love doing New Faces. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And I know you killed it and you ran the light, which is good.
Thank you.
You know what I mean? Like make it your own. Yeah. So, yeah, that's where I got discovered. That's, you know, I came up here, I did New Faces, and I left with a deal and quit the day job.
Did you really?
Wow, yeah. That's awesome.
Who gave you your first deal?
Greenblatt Gianellari. But he went on to run Showtime. At which point he had completely forgotten me.
Oh.
So, but yeah. That's
oh, Greenblatt.
Yeah.
Went to NBC.
Right.
Bob Greenblatt? Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that one.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, you know, that was, it was probably their first deal. They got better at it too. They were like, wait, we wasted that one. But yeah, that was my experience. So I'll always have an affinity for New Faces, and I always, like, I've hosted it twice, and I always pull for the comics because it was so good for me when I did it.
No, that's great.
Yeah.
So what's up with you, Alonzo? What are you doing next?
Well, this afternoon I'm hosting the awards show, which this will be my third one in a row. Every year I host the awards show, and my agents managed to parlay that into me hosting the awards show again.
Ooh.
So that's
nice.
You got some leverage.
I'm making moves there.
Big,
you know.
Great agent.
That one's going well. No, I actually... I love doing it because I never know what it's going to be.
Right.
So when I walk in, like, I may have an idea of one, maybe two jokes, and then the show takes on a life of its own.
Uh-huh.
So a couple of years ago, it was really funny because I kept doing this thing of asking every award winner to give me a job as a security guard, right? Like, I mean, I played that so many times. So I was like, Kenya Burris, put me on Blackish as a security guard. And, you know, Jim Carrey, can you get me in the next Liar? I'll play the bailiff and all of that. That was fun. Last year, the show got heavy.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, last year it got serious. Because we had, well, you know, Hannah Gadsby had her thing going, and her special was very heavy. And then Lil Rel talked about when he started and what it took to get him here. And then Tiffany Haddish, you know her story,
right?
From being a foster kid and everything. So it was very heavy last year. So I think the goal this year is to keep it from being heavy. Like, we don't care about your feelings.
We don't want to know your background.
Anything you want to protest, we don't care.
Yeah.
And, you know, because everyone's in a group now, right? Everyone has their group. They're you know, you're African American or you're gay or you're this. Like, we're so liberal. We're actually, this year, they're giving an award to a straight white male, which is the most persecuted
unrepresented
group on Earth. Yeah, they don't have a chance in this business, so we're going to help them out.
Is Southern Mama co-hosting?
No.
That's why they should give us an award. We'd keep it light.
Yeah.
Like, thanks, guys. And that would be our...
We have no problem. Yeah. See you next year.
We're cool with everything. Maybe that's why
is
we
that
don't
Is that
going to
be your
award.
Opening? You going to go
think,
with that?
You know, I don't know your experience with Tom, but I've known
learning.
Tom a while. And if Tom got, like, deep and serious with me, I wouldn't trust it for a minute. I'd be like, all right, what's he setting me up for? Because he's too funny. He's too funny. So anything really serious, you're like, this is leading to something hilarious.
Some yeah. bit where hey waters guys, show up at the table.
I can get deep and quiet. See well, that?
Yeah. I'm learning about Tom as
yeah,
we go.
Yeah, he's never not funny, so yeah. You got to keep an eye. He's quiet, but it's what he does.
He's always thinking about jokes.
And weed.
I'm usually thinking about food.
Yeah.
So I leave the comedy till after I've eaten.
How many motorcycles do you have now?
Five.
Five.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm a bike nut.
Everyone in LA, do you ever come to LA?
No.
Oh, you're going to after this new faces triumph of yours.
Have you ever visited? You've never visited?
I was in San Francisco like 3 weeks ago, but it never LA. It
doesn't count.
Yeah. Well, right. I don't know.
I wasn't trying to make it count.
I'm just kidding.
I don't know if you've heard, but there's a lot of traffic in LA.
Yeah, I heard about that.
Yeah. And Alonzo has five motorcycles and is never in traffic. He just zooms all around the city like it's 1940.
We can legally ride between traffic. Like, whoa. I know everywhere else people do it illegally, but in L.A. it's legal, so
I would be so scared to ride a motorcycle in L.A. because people don't pay attention. Everyone's on their phone.
Yeah, but I'm used to that.
Yeah.
So you know, you kind of develop a sixth sense, or you die, one or the other. So,
No,
I'm used to it. And the other thing is when you're on a bike, It's not as daunting as people think. You know,
yeah.
Like there's more space in between traffic and stuff than people think.
Alonzo's hardcore. My father's a biker. He
rides
Harleys out of New York.
Yeah.
And he goes to this rally every year in Lake George. It's called Americade. And all these bikers go there and they hang out and try and act cool. And they were there and my father calls me from like this one night. And he's at Alonzo's show at Americade.
Oh, that's awesome.
Do you know this guy, Alonzo? He's hilarious.
And the great thing about that is Tom's dad, like Tom looks exactly like his dad.
Oh, really?
So if you can just imagine.
Oh, I can imagine.
Look in the audience and there's an older version of Tom Papa.
I can imagine.
Getting off a motorcycle
just
and you're like, what kind of weird
big.
Twilight Zone is this? Tom is. Before they had that app. I saw Tom age 30 years.
Yeah, I know. When they did that face app thing, it was my father. It was very scary. I'm like, wow, my nose is going to get bigger. We have our guest who we thought might have been blowing it off. I'm blowing off three interviews today myself.
Oh, are you?
Yeah, it's the end of the festival. You don't really have to show up. But this guy showed up, and we want to bring him on right away. Michael Rapaport is here, everybody. Come on,
what's
Michael.
What's up, man?
Good to
Come
see
in,
you.
Come in, grab the mic.
Yeah, bring your coffee.
Yeah,
yeah,
do
that's
it.
Fine. I like the hat. Oh, are you... No, I love the Yankees.
No, yeah, he's a big Yankee.
I'm so glad you're here. We've never
glad
met.
To be here.
I've been a huge fan of yours for a long time.
I appreciate it. Sorry I'm late. It wasn't on purpose. The motherfucker didn't give me my wake-up call. He didn't give me my waters or my wake-up call.
Who, the hotel?
That fuck down there.
That guy.
We could curse. This is the radio, right?
Yeah, do your thing.
Sirius XM. Okay.
Did he at least give you a cookie when you checked in?
He gave me a cookie, and that's it. But I saw his decline. You know the guy I'm talking about. You see his decline. He had like a real spirit in him at first, and that shit just been sucked away from him.
It's all the comics,
agents, and comedians, and it's just like he had like a real sort of in my head. A French sort of like lightness. That shit just got sucked out of him.
Where he's just like, go back where you come from.
Get the fuck out of here. Like, you want an apple? Now there's no apple. Nothing, so.
You will not wake up tomorrow.
No, yeah. Wake me up.
Well, we're glad you made it.
Glad to be here.
Well, thanks for coming. Thank you. I have a question because I keep seeing you pop up at comedy clubs more and more in L.A.
Yep.
And but I always knew you as just an amazing actor.
Yep.
But you also have the comic thing of strong opinions and always being able to talk about it off the fly.
Yep.
So is this kind of a newish thing to be doing so many sets?
This phase of stand-up comedy is new for me. When I first started in 1989, I was 19 as a stand-up comedian.
Oh, that was your first?
That was my first thing as entertainment, like my first being paid for anything. It was like $20 was stand-up comedy. And I did that when I was 19, 20, 21, 22, and I did it in Los Angeles heavy at the Improv in L.A. They also had one in Santa Monica, and I was exposed to it. I loved it. I was so young. I wasn't that good of a comedian. I didn't understand the medium.
Right.
I was resentful if jokes worked. I thought it was like stupid. Like, why are you doing the same jokes if they work? I didn't understand. And I was 19, you know, so I wasn't like one of these comedic savants like Eddie Murphy. Like 19, he was like a freak, you know.
Who has?
and then but Eddie was my guy. Like I wanted to be Eddie Murphy. I didn't want to necessarily be a comedian. I wanted to be Eddie Murphy. And then I found acting. Fell in love with acting, and growing up, I always wanted to be a basketball player, and then I started doing comedy. But like when I first, literally the first time I started acting, like that was the thing that like was literally like you put a fish in water.
Right.
So then there was the infamous Michael Rapaport retirement of 93, which everybody still talks about from comedy.
Yeah, you know, people were still talking about it.
They talk about it getting over it. You know, like, oh, come back, and it's been like, you know, they've been pulling me. So then, I know it's hard for everybody to get over that retirement.
It is.
I know.
There's
documentaries made.
Every documentary about comedy, you always wait for the Rapaport retirement part
of 93.
Yeah, and like, where is he?
Like,
where
is he? When would he come back? Do you have any footage of him in 93? But then about I'd say about a year ago, comedians, because everybody's got a podcast,
right?
Yeah,
everybody's got a fucking podcast.
You got one too.
I got it. Yeah, but I mean, literally, podcasts are like assholes.
We all got one.
Everybody, my father's got a podcast. Everybody has a fucking podcast. But I had been doing different comedians' podcasts for reasons, and they were like, "You should do stand up. You should do stand up." And I was like, "I know. I was thinking about it." And you know, once you've been divorced once, you know, you think you have like something to say. And then I did a podcast with Bert Kreischer and Whitney Cummings, and they were like, "You should do stand up. You should do stand up." And Whitney was really like, "You should do stand up. You should do stand up." And I was like, and I said, I was thinking about it. She said, "I'm doing new stuff at the Improv."
The lab.
She said, "Just come and introduce me."
Yeah.
Right.
She said, "Just come on stage and introduce me."
Oh, that's great.
And I was like, "All right, fine, I'll do it." You know, because she was so nice to me.
Yeah.
So I was like, "I'll try to," you know. But she was like, "You could go do 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or you could literally just go. Whitney's coming on stage." Mm-hmm. So I fucked around with some stuff. I felt comfortable.
Nice.
And this is like 8 months ago, and I was like, and I kept, you know, going back, and
right,
you know, and here we are, and you know, I'm enjoying it.
So how do you feel? Like, I mean, it's like starting over.
It's like starting over. You know, I love it. You know, I respect the medium so much. I respect comedians so much.
Yeah.
You know, for me, it's just being clear on what type of comedian I want to be.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know.
Yeah.
But I feel like that would be pretty much baked in, like you are very distinct. I
don't
really. A
lot of opinions.
Yeah, you know, you don't think opinions. Like what would Michael think about
but
this?
But what, you know, like, I'm still figuring out, because I'm such a fan of it and I have such respect for the medium.
Yeah.
So I'm figuring that out. But I'm definitely comfortable on stage. I'm comfortable expressing my opinions, and you just, you know, carving out your shit. I know that because I have a certain, fame or whatever,
right.
People know me from being an actor and being a podcaster, whatever the fuck, that lends me to have opportunities. But at the end of the day, you know, you get up there, people are excited to see you, then they need a show.
Yeah. Right. They'll
give you a little time. So that part of it has been fun. I've gotten in these last 8 months so many seen so many different comedians, and there's so many different types of comedians.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's crazy. Like, all different, you know, hipster comedians, gay comedians, straight comedians, shit talking comedians, politically correct comedians, tattooed comedians, you know.
Right.
It's wild, you know, like all the different kinds. And you know, but at the end of the day, it's like you have to get up there and make motherfuckers laugh.
Yeah.
So all the gimmicks and, you know, your shit. You're in the service business, right?
Yeah. I would love to see you as the as a hipster comedian. That would make me laugh.
See, that's what I say when I'm trying to figure out what kind of comedian.
Get your
skinny jeans. There's a hipster in me.
Yeah.
You know. So I'm digging it. I'm having a lot of fun.
That's cool.
I've had a lot of great opportunities to get on stage and
really
try
great.
To do my thing.
Cristela Alonzo, where
get
are you?
Get on in here, Cristela.
Come over here, Cristela. Thanks for coming.
How you doing? How you doing?
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. How's your JFL going?
You guys, I've been here for 3 weeks.
Three? No.
I'm hosting the ethnic show. I've been here for 3 weeks.
Oh, you really have?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Literally?
Yeah.
What are you doing coming to this interview?
I don't know.
Yeah,
honestly, why did I say yes?
Why are you not napping?
You know, I said yes before I came to Canada.
Yes.
So I was so full of hope.
Right. Yeah.
I was like, I want to do everything. Give it to me. And yes. I'm like, what? It's when you say yes to the gig. Months before.
Uh-huh. Exactly.
And then the night before the gig, you're like, What have I done
on a Sunday night? What was I thinking?
When you say yes, you're like, I can do a set Sunday night.
I know. You're so stupid. So you never did New Faces.
No.
But you weren't around very long when you got your show, right?
What do you mean you weren't around very
long? Like you hadn't been...
Oh, I had been doing stand-up for 10 years.
Oh, it was 10 years?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I thought it was earlier
than that. No, I started doing stand-up in 2002, and I was the person... It was really hard for me to do stand-up because I started doing stand-up in Dallas where I was just a comic.
Right.
And then when I moved to L.A., clubs told me I was a Latino comic.
Ah.
So then... I couldn't do clubs. They sent me to go do the Latino circuit, which is like Latino bars and restaurants.
Right.
So I was kind of invisible from the club scene.
Oh, I got it. So that's why it felt like you were brand new.
Yeah. So then I ended up, I was lucky enough to pay my bills with NACA. I did college gigs and I did like a bunch. I was like one of the most booked comics. So I treated the college gigs like a 1 hour open mic where you had to learn how to work clean and blah blah blah.
Yeah.
And then when I got the show, I actually got the show because I did a spot on Conan at like late night 2012. It was my first late night spot ever, and I had already been doing stand-up for 10 years at that point. I'm that person, I don't like to do things early. Like I want to know that I'm ready to do something. So like JP Buck from Conan had reached out. I did a set at Comedy and Magic. I did like my 5 minutes that I had been working on that I figured if I ever do late night, this is my set.
Yeah, yeah.
And I did it and JP booked me, had no notes and said, do the set the way you did it.
Uh-huh.
And I did it and doing the college gigs and having to talk about myself and like really work on my stand up, that and Conan got me the show.
That's great.
You know, because I was accidentally crafting this set that they wanted for a show, and I didn't know. And honestly, like I never thought I was ever gonna get a show because I'm brown. So I always just wanted to do stand up.
Wow.
You know, so for me it was all bonus. Like I didn't expect it. But then when I got the show, everybody thought I had just come up because I had never really had a chance to perform at the clubs.
Under the radar.
So it was this thing where I came up and I was able to do an hour and I was able to do everything, you know. And so it was really kind of cool, you know. And
that is such a great thing.
That's your sweet spot. That's why you're there. That's why you're doing it.
Yeah. Hey, I have a nice surprise.
What?
Howie Mandel, come on up. Yeah. Come on up, buddy.
Yeah, Howie Mandel. He's like, wait, what?
Yeah, look at this. You know Alonzo. You know
Cristela. How's it going, Howie? Come on in.
Cristela.
See you, buddy.
Good to see you, man.
Good.
Right here.
Sit by Tom.
Grab a thing.
Grab a mic. Grab you sit by the mic.
Wow, this is really a surprise.
Welcome.
I had no idea that I'd be here.
Welcome to our hit show.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for this surprise.
Thank you.
Let me just settle down from the surprise.
It's Howie, exciting, you're dressed really cool. Like, you dress very dope.
Your sneakers are new and shiny and... Yeah, I'm loving everything.
Well, when I know that I want to always wear my best shoes on a podcast. I wear shit shoes every place else, but if I think that I might surprise somebody on a podcast,
this is a real radio show.
We're a real radio show.
Oh, it's not a podcast. What is the difference between a radio show and a podcast? Oh, I thought podcast on radio.
Well. That's radio.
There's literally no difference.
No one really knows the difference.
See, that's how
big
a surprise it is. I have no idea what I'm doing.
You were hilarious just right off the bat as a comedian. I remember watching you, and you were just so explosive and funny. But more than just staying funny for all that time, like you seem to have navigated your way through show business in such a cool way.
No, the thing. No, the truth is.
Is it really?
No, I didn't. I don't. There's no navigation involved.
What did you? What's what, the,
if there's a door that's unlocked, I'll walk in. I'm on your show.
Right. You were supposed to be at the brunch.
Right. I'm a surprise. I was sitting at the back. I'll just show up to anything. You ask me to be there, I'll be there.
That's how it
Whether
happens.
I'm in focus or not.
That's really how your career unfolded?
Absolutely.
You just kept walking
absolutely.
Doors?
I didn't even aspire to be a comedian.
Really?
For real?
For real. I'll tell you, and if you look at a lot of the old YouTube of me,
yeah.
You will agree with me that yeah. This guy couldn't have us. No, the truth of the matter is that I have, and I've talked about this endlessly and ad nauseum, I have like mental health issues. And I suffered from anxiety. I do suffer from anxiety and depression and OCD, and I just suffer.
Right.
And I wasn't diagnosed, and I didn't finish school, and I don't have a GED, and I'm really impulsive without thinking of ramifications, and I don't dance.
Right.
And the thing was that in the 70s, you know, discos were very big, and I don't disco dance, and I didn't go to clubs. And then this comedy boom happened in the mid 70s.
Right.
And I was a kid in Toronto, and I went to the Yuck Yucks because I don't dance.
Right.
And I'd never seen live stand up. I've watched it on The Tonight Show.
Right.
And there's a host in Canada, the guy who started Yuck Yucks, Mark Breslin. Mm-hmm. After I watched the show, he said to the audience, you know, on Monday nights at midnight, we have amateur night. If anybody would like to get up and try their ware, they should do it. And somebody sitting beside me said, you should go up. And
I went, how old are you?
Now?
No, then.
22. And I was in retail because I had been thrown out of school. I had nothing and no aspiration to do this.
Right.
And somebody said, you should go up Monday. I went, okay. And once I say okay, I'll do it.
Yeah. Right.
And no prep. No, nothing.
No, thought. Not one joke.
Not one joke.
Yeah.
I have nothing. Uh-huh. I'm being honest with you. Nothing.
Yeah.
And my joke is that Howie Mandel is going to take a stage
right.
and be introduced.
Right.
That's the joke. Uh-huh. That's the punchline. That's the setup. That's all I have. I'm going to show up. It's going to be a fucking nightmare.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be at the center of this nightmare. That right. I swear to you, that's the joke. So it comes. I hear, ladies and I'm backstage with people who want to do this.
Right.
I don't.
Yeah. Hey, what am I doing here?
No. I don't even ask. If I asked one question, yeah. then my path would be different. I don't ask a yeah. question.
Right.
And he goes, ladies and gentlemen, Howie Mandel, and I walk out, and the lights are in my eye, and that's the end of my joke.
Yeah.
And then I look down into the audience, and there's people.
Right.
There's people. Something I don't have any anticipation, just like I had no anticipation of what today was going to be, and I didn't even know I wasn't on a podcast. So I look down, and they're kind of waiting, and then I realize, oh, maybe I have to deliver something. So if you look at old YouTube videos of me,
yeah,
that's exactly what I'm doing, trying to figure out what to deliver. So I started going, okay, all right, okay. And they started laughing like you're laughing. And I went, what? Okay, all right. What do you? All right. And that was my whole, okay. Oh, I got it.
People like me love that.
Yeah. No, but they did. They were laughing. Yeah. And I go, what? Tell me what you're laughing at. And if you look at all my, it was just me trying to come up with shit. I had nothing. And as I told you, I have OCD, and I always carried rubber gloves because I don't want to touch shit.
Yeah. That's why you have the gloves?
Why else would you? And self-prostate exam. I pulled a glove out of my pocket because I had nothing, and it's standing there silent. I pull it over my head. I start breathing. The fingers are going up. They're roaring even more. I pop it off. And then Mark Breslin comes up to me and says, can you do this again tomorrow? I went, yeah, I'll come back. And it was the first time in my life that I found a place, and they started inviting me back. Still, no aspiration of making this a career, but I found a place where there were kind of like-minded, odd people who felt like I never fit in. I didn't have friends.
Yeah.
I didn't have any place to go. I wasn't into sports. Mm-hmm. And so I showed up, and I got free drinks and cookies.
Yeah.
And fries. And then I did.
So, yeah. That's so Canadian.
What?
We have cookies.